Shalom, and welcome to Via Havta Yisrael, a Hebrew phrase which means, you shall love Israel. We hope you'll stay with us for the next 30 minutes as our teacher, Dr. Baruch, shares his expository teaching from the Bible. Dr. Baruch is the senior lecturer at the Zera Avraham Institute based in Israel. Although all courses are taught in Hebrew at the Institute, Dr. Baruch is pleased to share this weekly address in English. To find out more about our work in Israel, please visit us on the web at loveisrael.org. That's one word, loveisrael.org. Now, here's Baruch with today's lesson.
You know, when you are a believer, you are naturally going to be optimistic because you know this biblical truth. With God, all things are possible. And because of that statement, which is 100% accurate, we can take it and hold on to it in every circumstance. With God, all things are possible. And because of that, I have a positive outlook on my future and also the future of other believers. Well, take out your Bible, look with me to the book of Hebrews and chapter 6. Last week, we concluded a study of eternal security, and it ended by saying that there are those who are very close to being cursed by God, those who are going to be consumed by His judgment. But notice what He says to believers. Look with me, Hebrews chapter 6, and we're going to begin in verse 9. Now, there's a word, it's the second word in this verse. This word can never begin the sentence in Greek. It's always in the number two position. It is a conjunction, and what it says is, what I have just said, now I'm going to say something very different. I'm going to say something in a different way. So he's not talking about judgment and being cursed. Notice what he says, verse 9. But being convinced or being assured or trusting, however you want to translate that word, but being convinced concerning you, beloved, of what? Of better things which have salvation. So what did he just talk about? Well, there's only two possibilities. You are either going to experience the curse of God eternally, or you are going to experience salvation. Nothing in between, either yes or no. And what I like about this passage of Scripture, he says, and notice how he addresses the people, beloved ones, those who are recipients of the love of God. And there's only one source that you can find the love of God, and that is through Messiah. Now, in this section, we have seen that the writer of Hebrews had been talking about Messiah Yeshua, that is Jesus Christ, as our great high priest. He is going to speak more and extensively about Yeshua being high priest in the next chapter, chapter 7. But never let that fact that he's our high priest leave your thoughts when you study the book of Hebrews. It is the foundational truth that permeates all of this epistle. And because he's our high priest, we can be assured of what he says, salvation. And he says, thus also we have spoken. And he's been teaching that. And he's been speaking that salvation message to these people. Look now to verse 10. For he says, God is not unjust or unrighteous that God should forget your good works. Now, notice how he goes back to that. Those who he is convinced of better things for, those that he's assured that they're going to experience salvation. Why? Because there's evidence of Messiah into their life. In the same way we talked about last week, how when it rains upon land, that land gives vegetation. And when the Holy Spirit, who is oftentimes personified as water, living waters, when he enters into the person, there's going to be a harvest. There's going to be a production of fruit, the fruit of the Spirit. There's going to be good works. And that's why, look once more, he says in verse 10, for God is not unrighteous that he should forget your good works. There's going to be good works and the labor of love. See, having experienced His love, that love of God that enters through the gospel, it causes us to also demonstrate love. The fact that He first loved me gives me the ability to love others because they deserve it, because they ask for it. No, because that is my new nature. And why do I talk about a new nature? Well, look again at this passage. He says, God is not unjust. He is someone that every good deed that you do, He remembers. And what the scripture says in the book of Revelation, when Messiah comes back, He is going to render to every man according to his deeds. So if you do not get a reward here, thank God, because a greater reward is coming to you. It is going to be paid out in a kingdom experience, and that reward is going to be eternal. That which we receive in this age, well, it might be needed. It is certainly appreciated. It can help, but it's going to wear out. It is going to fade away. Kingdom blessings are for eternity. So God's not going to forget the good works and the labor of your love. It's not an obligation. It is not being coerced. It's not saying, I've got to do these things. No, it's a labor of love, which you have manifested. Why? For His name. And what does name in the Bible, what is it synonymous to? Character. So because I've received the love of God in my life, and that love is really His chief characteristic trait. He is a God of love. Does that mean He doesn't have judgment? Of course not. It's because He loves righteousness that He judges sin. But what we're reading here is this, that we're going to do good works because we want to manifest His name. Having ministered to the saints, other believers, and are ministering to them. Look now at verse 11. He says here, and we desire for each one of you the same thing. What is that? That you should demonstrate a urgency or a haste or a diligence with all assurance of the hope until the very end. Now, what he's promising is this. Those who are believers who have received salvation, which means we become recipients of the love of God. And because love is God's, one of His chief characteristic traits, unto the fact that the scripture says God is love, we are going to see His character become our character. And that's what spiritual growth is all about. And when God's character becomes our character, it is going to manifest itself in ministry. And that's exactly what it says here, that we are going to minister, having ministered to the saints, and it also says, and are ministering. Therefore, verse 11, we desire each one of you this same thing, that you should manifest this diligently with all assurance of the hope until the end. Now, why does he use that word assurance? And it's a word here, if you look at it, it's a word for wisdom and fullness. So the word assurance here is full wisdom. This is what it's trying to tell us. When you have spiritual wisdom, when you understand the things of God in a complete way, you know what you're going to be assured of? You're assured of that hope. You're not going to say, well, I'm not sure. I hope in an English sense, I hope I'm saved. You know what's sad? I have a friend and he lives in Miami, Florida, and his denomination did a survey. They called people and they were assisted by that denomination's leadership. They called people, believers in churches, but those who were in leadership. Example, those who were elders or deacons, those who taught Sunday school, those who were the pillars of the church. And they asked them a very simple question, and that is, if you die tonight, will you be in heaven? And you know what 80% of the people answered? I hope so. What a lousy answer. It's not I hope so. We know so. What is the scripture telling us? We have assurance. What did Messiah promise us? eternal life. And therefore, although we're in a new week, we need to remember what we talked about last week, that proof that the writer gives us of our eternal salvation. And therefore, he writes in this passage of Scripture, very clearly, he says that we have full assurance of the hope, and we maintain that to the very end. What is that? Until the kingdom. We are not going to waver. We're not going to have doubt. We're not going to be unsure. We're not going to have an earthly hope, which means, well, I don't know, but I hope this is the case. No, we have full assurance unto the very end. Verse 12, in order that you should not be slothful. See, when you lack assurance, when you really don't believe in the promises of God, when you are not kingdom-minded, the outcome of that is what he says here, that you're going to be slothful. That is, you're going to be, that's another word for lazy. When you look at this Greek word and you see the New Testament in Hebrew, it uses the word atzlanim, that they're going to be lazy ones. We ought not be lazy. We should be on fire. We should be those who are encouraged to walk with God, serve God, because we know it has eternal significance. So he says, look once more, verse 12, in order that you are not slothful, but, here's that word, in contrast to, but rather be imitators of those through faith and patience. That perseverance, that ability to suffer long, that's literally what the word is, to suffer long. Those who are inheriting, what do we inherit? Inheriting the promise. There is an inherent relationship here between hope and promise. Why is that? Because true biblical hope is in the promises of God. What God has written down, what he has given to us by way of a covenantal agreement. So why can I be assured of these things, fully assured? Because God has sealed them to me as promises wrapped up in a covenant, and God keeps his covenantal promises. That's why we see Jewish people going back to the land. These people, I was reading about an organization, and I forget what the name of the organization is, but they are foolish. And why do I say that? Because they speak about Jerusalem and they say that Jerusalem of today has no connection with the promises or the future purposes of God. How foolish. How foolish. Where is Messiah coming to? Where is he going to rule from? But these people don't believe in a literal kingdom, a kingdom that is going to be that first expression, a millennial kingdom. They don't believe that God keeps covenant with the Jewish people. They speak negatively to them as a rebellious people, meaning that God has terminated all covenantal responsibility. No. See, why God is moving and bringing people back to the land is because the land is still part of his covenant purposes, and so are the people. Are Jewish people, I'm being Jewish, are we rebellious? Yes, we are. But so is Gentiles. And the point is, it is not our rebelliousness that terminates the covenant. God has said that he is going to keep that covenant. Now, with the individual Jew in his rebellion or her rebellion, they can miss out on the promises. But there's going to be a remnant because of the faithfulness of God that are going to receive that. And it's that remnant that's going to receive that right to the land and who are going to be part of that covenant people, the foundation of it in the millennial kingdom. That is all to scream to us that God is faithful to his word. And that's why here we can have full assurance. We can believe and have a perfect hope rest in the promises of God. Look now to verse 13. It says here, for to Abraham God promised, since according to no one, he had no one greater to swear. Therefore he swore on himself. Now we're going to see, especially in chapter 7, that this idea of an oath is so important. So make a note, when God made that new covenant promise through the gospel, through the ministry of the great high priest, Yeshua, he did so through an oath, and that's vital. Remember that, it's key. So God made promises to Abraham, And because there was no one greater to swear to, he swore to himself, saying, I will, and he uses the word blessing twice. We might translate, I will certainly bless you, and that's fine. So he says, I will certainly bless you, but just so that you know, in the biblical language, both in Hebrew and Greek, looking at the Greek, it appears twice, the word blessing. I will certainly bless you, and I will make you abundant. And here again, the word abundant is repeated twice. So I will multiply you, and he says, and thus he, referring to Abraham, he endured, he was patient, and he obtained the promise. So here's an example of God's faithfulness. If you are not recipients of his promise, just wait. What does he say here? Endure. You might have to suffer a long time, but in the end, he says, and Abraham's the example, he is going to be recipient of the promises. Look now to verse 16. He says here, for men, according to a greater one, swears. So we see a principle. When we take an oath, we do it in one who is greater. And all disputes, they are brought to an end by the confirmation, which is the oath. That's what he says. So someone's unsure, someone doubts this agreement. What happens? One swears, he takes an oath in one who is greater than him, and it brings an end, it confirms this issue, and it removes the doubt, it takes it away. Look now to verse 17. In which, all the more so, God wanting to do something, God wanting to demonstrate, this is very important, God wanting to demonstrate to those who were going to inherit his promises. And what did we read here? There's a very important word. Now, usually that word, and we're going to underscore it when we come to chapter 7 and verses 11 and 12. But we have to lay the foundation now. Because when we understand what is said here at the end of chapter 6, it is going to give us the paradigm, the perspective, to understand what's so important and so misunderstood today in chapter 7. If you misunderstand it, you're going to have wrong consequences. So what do we have here? Well, context shows us and leads us to a proper conclusion. He's giving an example. He says, you know, God, he had no one else greater to him to swear, so he swore to himself. But we understand the pattern. When we look at human beings, when they want to confirm something, when they want to remove any doubt, when they want this dispute to go away, they swear by one who is greater. Now you see the correlation? God is giving an example that has a foundational truth to it. Men swear by one who is greater. And God, in wanting to show the fidelity of his word, he wanted to swear by someone greater than himself. But the problem is, there is no one greater than God. So God swore in himself, but that's sufficient. But you see the pattern. How men behave in swearing in someone greater is also being given to understand what God's doing. So these two things, the fact that men are being swear by one who is greater, helps us understand, it gives us the paradigm for understanding that God made an oath. Now, why do I say these things being set side by side? Because if you look at that word, and more often than not, in English, this word is going to be translated changeable or unchangeable. Now, here, what we find is this. What it means is two things being set side by side, or two things that can't be set side by side because they're so different. And sometimes when we look at how man behaves, you can't put God next to it because God is greater than these things, and that's what it's saying here. And because God is greater, remember, there's no one greater than him, it says that he wanted to confirm his purpose. And he did so by mediating it through an oath. He made a promise. But you can't put it side by side. Why? Man swears by someone greater. God didn't do that. Why? Because no one is greater than him. But what he says can be believed. Look now at verse 18. In order by two. Did you hear that? Two. Why two? Why is that number there? Well, it's there because two things are being compared. That's vital that you see that. This word, and the word in question is the word metatithemi. Tithemi is a Greek word which means to place something, to set something down. The word meta, the prefix, is the word with. So you're setting something down with something else. Two things are being set side by side. Now let's pause for a moment. Because what we're learning is this. We're learning that God is revealing to us truth by setting two things side by side so that we have a framework to understand it. That's what he's saying. And in this case, how man behaves, well, God can't do it. He can't set this side by side because God has no one greater to swear by. And therefore, what's the promise? He said, by two things, and the word is here for thing. It's a word pragmatic in Greek, where we get that word pragmatic. It means something that is just, you know, easy to understand. It's pragmatic. It's self-evident. So by these two things that can't be set side by side, it's what? That God is unable to lie. Now, he's setting these two things side by side, and he's telling us God is not able to lie. Here's the problem. If you understand this, as most people do, you're lacking one thing. What is that? What are the two things that are unchangeable? One is God cannot lie. That's right. He cannot lie. What's the other? Where do you see in this passage? You don't. And that tells us that you're not understanding the context and the nature of these biblical words. It's saying God put two things side by side. What is that? That man, when they want to remove all doubt, they take an oath in one greater. But God couldn't do that because there's no one greater. But relax. Why? Well, we can believe that because it says God cannot lie. And therefore, we have greater encouragement for those who are fleeing. What are we fleeing? We're fleeing from this world because the world offers no hope. We are fleeing from this world and we're going to him in order that we might, what does it say? Grab hold of the hope which is laid before us. And what is that? The promises of God. We can be assured of them. Why? Because God cannot lie. They are act as an anchor. We have an anchor for our soul that is sure and also trustworthy or confirmed. So because of what God has said, it is an anchor for our souls. That's what we have by his proclamation. And it anchors our soul in assurance and trust. In order that, what can we do now? Well, because of this great high priest, now we're coming to the end of chapter 6. But in chapter 7, we're going to underscore the ministry of who? Messiah as high priest. And because of his work, what are we able to do? Well, remember how chapter 4 ends. It says, seeing that we have a great high priest that passed through the heavens, let us hold fast to that confession and go boldly to what? The throne of grace. Where's that throne of grace? It's in the Holy of Holies. And what separates the holy place from the most holy place, the Holy of Holies? A veil. And that's why it says here, because of God's promise, it's true, it's assured. We have this hope. God cannot lie. It says, therefore, we can enter into the inner veil. Why? Because we have a forerunner that has entered. So our forerunner who has entered in our behalf. Who is that forerunner who has entered? Yeshua. And he's done so. Who's Yeshua? He's done so according to the order of Melchizedek, becoming high priest for how long? For eternity. Why is that important? It's important because, and we'll see this in the next chapter, He lays a truth and then he supports it later on. It's a wonderful epistle to teach us. And what he's teaching us is this. See, other high priests, well, they served for a limited period of time. Why? We'll see. They die. Sometimes they just retire from that. But Messiah, what does he become? He's like the order of Melchizedek. Why is that important? We'll see in chapter 7. But he has secured a priesthood for how long? Forever. And because he's high priest forever, you know what we can be assured? That his ministry lasts forever. Whatever he obtained in his ministry, it is going to be ongoing forever and ever. It is eternal. So what do I want to say? I want to share with you that when we talk about the benefit of having this great high priest, Yeshua, what he provides us, what is that? Eternal life. You know, if it just says he gives us life, we should be wise enough to know because of his priesthood is eternal, the life he gives is eternal. And therefore, the scripture says over and over about our eternal salvation so that we can be assured. And all of this comes, if you look at the context of this last part of chapter 6 of Paul, of the epistle to the Hebrews, we don't know who wrote it. If we look at it, it's all about a promise that God made to Abraham. And now through the ministry of Yeshua, we become the seed of Abraham. We have that hope, a hope that is real, certain, established, confirmed by the Word of God, that we are going to be heirs of that promise. And where ultimately are we receiving that promise? The answer is in the kingdom of God. Now, when I look at this epistle to the Hebrews, I find great encouragement. But once again, we have to understand it in the way that the author of this book reveals it. And what does he do? He uses as a foundation the Torah as teaching us Torah truth so that we can understand the New Testament truth. Because if we don't understand the Old Testament truth, we're going to be very unable to understand this new revelation because one is being set aside the other for a greater understanding. Well, once more, I'm out of time. Until next week, and we enter into the book of Hebrews and chapter 7.
Well, we hope you will benefit from today's message and share it with others. Please plan to join us each week at this time and on this channel for our broadcast of loveisrael.org. Again, to find out more about us, please visit our website, loveisrael.org. There you will find articles and numerous other lectures by Baruch. These teachings are in video form. You may download them or watch them in streaming video. Until next week, may the Lord bless you in our Messiah Yeshua, that is, Jesus, as you walk with Him. Shalom from Israel.